Though we do not deserve your goodness, you still provide for all our needs of body and soul. Grant us your Holy Spirit that we may acknowledge your gifts, give thanks for your benefits, and serve you in willing obedience. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Thank you.
angry? Yeah, that happens at my house all the time. About every 2 hours, I think. If you get so hungry, you get hangry. Well, I think that's kind of what was happening in the Bible story for today, in the gospel lesson that I read. All of these people had come out to see Jesus and to listen to him talk, and they had been there a long time listening to Jesus. And there were 5,000 men with their children and their wives. And after a while, they started to get not just hungry, but they started to get hangry. Angry and hungry together. And the disciples, the friends of Jesus, said, well, why don't you send them all home so they can go get something to eat? And Jesus said, no. I want you guys to feed them. And they looked at the crowd and said, these guys are hangry. If I don't give them enough food, they're going to kill us. Because they're just like starving to death. And they said, all we have is a couple of fish and a little bit of bread. Not enough to feed this group. Just look at them. Some of them are like orange woolly, aren't they? Do you think two fish and there are two loaves and five fish can feed 5,000 people? Not good enough. So, some of you didn't have breakfast this morning, so I brought some food for us. Here. I have a supper. And I think I'll open it up and we can pass it out each table and then we can let have it. Here, I'll just, you can just open it up and just take one link each and then pass it along so everyone can at least get a taste. Will that make you feel something? Will that satisfy your anger? And one sucker isn't going to do it, is it? Just like two loaves of fish and five, or two loaves of bread and five fish isn't going to feed 5,000 people. You need more than that. So Jesus said, bring the food to me. And he prayed over it. He lifted up his hands and said, Father, satisfy their desire. And something amazing happened. Instead of having just a couple of fish and some loaves, everybody got something to eat. Not only did everyone eat, their stomachs were so full, they had to let their pants off. Now that's a lot of food. There were leftovers. There were 12 baskets of food left over. That was incredible. And God performed a miracle. He said, you know what? The greatest miracle is not the fish and the bread. The best miracle is that God feeds us with something that is even better. He gives us his body and blood in Holy Communion. You look up at the altar there, you see underneath that white cloth? That's Holy Communion. And under there, God gives us to eat the flesh and blood of Jesus so that our hearts will be satisfied. Even though our souls are hangry because of sin, God says, I will take that away as you eat and drink for the forgiveness of sins. And when you get a little bit older and you go through confirmation, you too can come and receive this food that God gives to you. Would you like to do that someday? Do this. So I can do that. This way you go away. Okay. All right. Well, here's your summary. You can all share this. Oh, maybe if I perform a miracle, can I do a miracle? Oh, guess what? God made a miracle! So that's talking. You pick up the wrong sucker. That was cheap, wasn't it? And you can take whatever, and you can hold over your brain. You can just stand there. Let's hold our hands and pray. Dear Jesus, thank you for feeding us.
Thank you for feeding us.
Not just with fish and bread.
Not just with fish and bread.
But with your body and blood.
With your body and blood.
That you satisfy our greatest need.
That you satisfy our greatest need.
Amen.
Amen.
Now you may turn to seats. There are both of us.
Thank you.
Was it a 5-star restaurant with a 7-course dinner and 13 pieces of silverware? Was that the greatest meal you've ever had? Maybe it was a backyard picnic where you're gathered around with some family and friends and you just put some burgers and rods on the grill and it was just the environment and the social. Maybe it was a place like this. This is Linker Lodge in Bradenton, Florida. Linker Lodge is famous because it's out in the middle of the swamp and all of the stuffed animals were actually caught right there in the swamp. And there's rattlesnakes and alligators and mountain lions, there's all kinds of stuff. And that's where you can get the best alligator tail I've ever eaten. Perhaps the best meal that you ever had was the family-style chicken at Bavarian Inn in Frankenmuth, Michigan. Anyone been there? Awesome. Fantastic. We used to go every year on my mom's birthday, and they always had a duck dinner. It's the only time you could get really good duck. It was great. For Pete Callahan, the best meal he ever ate was a bologna sandwich and an apple. You see, Steve was a sailor, and he liked to make his own sailing vessels, and he made a sailboat that he intended to sail across the ocean with. And in January of 1982, he set out from the Canary Island to sail across the ocean. He got 6 days into his sail, and his boat sank. He had a get into the life raft, which was about 5 feet long. And in that life raft, he had 3 pounds of food and 1 gallon of water. And he survived with a makeshift spear for the next 72 days on the ocean. And in that time, he suffered malnourishment, severe sunburn, and multiple shark attacks. And one of the shark attacks, they hit the boat so hard that it ruptured one of the bladders of the boat. And he spent the next 33 days keeping his boat afloat by constantly bailing water out of his boat. And finally, after more than 2.5 months of being at sea in his little lifeboat, he had traveled more than 1,800 miles of open water. And a fishing vessel found him. And when he climbed on board, the only thing they had to eat was a bologna sandwich and an apple. And to Steve, he said, "This is the greatest meal I've ever eaten in my life." You see, the value of a meal increases with the proportion of the hunger. It tastes better if you're hungry. And the more hungry you are, the more starved you are, the better the meal becomes. And that's a lesson that Jesus provides for us in our gospel lesson today. In Matthew chapter 14, we hear the encounter of Jesus feeding 5,000 men, their wives and their children. But this meal of fish and bread, given to people who had been maybe 8-9 hours out in the wilderness, maybe I can only imagine that the children were starting to get hangry. If they had teenagers, this would have been ugly. Can you imagine the teenagers bugging mom and dad, "Let's go, I'm starving"? I'm sure that would have gone over well. And after a while, they would probably say, "When is this going to end?" And so, Jesus feeds them some bread and some fish, but however, this meal pales in comparison to the great miraculous meal that was given to us on Monday, Thursday. You see, don't forget that the value of the meal is in proportion to the hunger that we have. And the hunger we have for that great holy meal is tremendous because of the nature of our sin. Now, before we get too much into this miracle, there's an interesting phrase that begins our gospel text today in verse 13. It begins with these words. Now, when Jesus had heard this, it's like reading a book in the middle. There's something before this. What had this he heard? What had happened before that caused Jesus to withdraw to a desolate place by himself? What is the this of the story? Well, if you just go back one or two verses, you'll find out that this is the death of John the Baptist. We know that John had been murdered by Herod because of his wife's jealousy, because of John's preaching of righteousness. And in the text immediately before our gospel lesson, In verse 12, we read these words. His disciples came, they took his body, they buried it, and then they went and told Jesus. So Jesus has just received the news that his cousin, the man he called the no greater man born among women on earth, has just been murdered and buried by his disciples. Jesus needs to get away and process this, to think through it, perhaps even to grieve such sin would cause by the world that would cause the death of a man like that. Now what about the people? What were they doing? Where did this big crowd come from? How did they just happen to show up at that moment? Matthew tells us, but when the crowds heard it, the same thing. The crowds had heard also that John the Baptist had been killed. Then they followed him on foot into the town from the towns. So the people had heard the death of John the Baptist, and they wanted to follow Jesus. Why was this important? Well, the Bible doesn't say exactly, but it does give us a couple of good clues of where this crowd came from. Remember how he was preaching and baptizing when John was alive? The Pharisees had asked John, are you Elijah, return to life? Are you a great prophet? Are you the Messiah that we're supposed to expect? Are you the Christ? John had said no to these things. John had said, it's not me. And he put it up on the shore and said, behold, that's the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And yet the people did not fully understand what he was talking about. These same people didn't comprehend that John was not the Messiah. In fact, they were looking for him. In chapter 16, Jesus asked the disciples, who do people say that I am? Remember their answer? No, you're on the screen. Some say you are John the Baptist. You see, some people were thinking that Jesus was John the Incarnate, or that John was the Messiah. They were misled by this. This confirms how fixated the people were on who John was and what he had done. And so just as Jesus heard this news and he had to go off to a desolate place to pray, to contemplate, to commune with God, so too the people were grieving the death of one that they thought was a holy man. It's not surprising upon hearing the death of John that the people would now turn to Jesus. Whether they believed he was the Messiah or not, they wanted something to give them hope. Something to give them comfort and peace. They wanted something to believe in. They had placed their hope and their promises in the message of John and his baptizing, and now he's dead. They were grieving just like Jesus was, and they were looking for something to hold on to. It would be natural for them to turn to Jesus. He was the only teacher who had an explanation about what was happening. And so the people leave their towns and villages and they follow Jesus to where he's at. So Jesus arrives on shore, and as soon as he sees this large crowd, we're talking a big group of people. Last night or this weekend, my family went down to the Irish Fest for the first time. It was pretty incredible. They said 40,000 people were showing up. I think I knew about half of them. There were a lot of people there. So we're talking in that same range, about 15,000 to 20,000 husbands, wives, and children who had gathered on a hillside to find hope and peace, to find comfort and a message in this day of need. And while they were there, Jesus preached and taught them. The Bible doesn't say how long they were there. I suspect it was a good Lutheran sermon, 15, 20 minutes. You go 25, people start to get a little nervous. I don't think so. I think they've been there for hours, most of the day, into the afternoon, and maybe even approaching evening, enough that the people were starting to get angry. Not just hungry, but hangry. So the disciples say, Jesus, they're starting to get restless. The thing is, I'm looking in their eyes, and they're not happy with what's going on here. They come out to be satisfied, and they're not. Send them away to get something to eat, and everything will be okay. You've preached a good sermon. All you're missing now is an offering. All you're missing now is a meal. So send them away. They had a plan. Jesus said, I have a different plan. You see, they had come out seeking something that would give them peace and security, and they had problems. They wanted something as simple as food. Isn't it amazing? When we are in distress, there are certain trigger bodily within us that wants to be comforted. And one of the things that people find comfort in is food. In fact, we have a term for it, don't we? Comfort food. There's a reason it's called comfort food. Because when you've eaten a good meal, a familiar meal, a meal that reminds you of home or makes you, gives you a sense of stability, something that is normal. And they were looking for comfort. Jesus makes it clear that he is not about to send these people home. Even though that they had come looking for something that they thought John could provide, Jesus gives them another message. He doesn't send them away. You know what? He doesn't send us away either. No matter how angry that crowd was, Jesus was there to provide them more than they ever imagined. No matter how sinful we are, no matter what is in your past, no matter what is in your present, no matter what you're struggling with right now, what secrets you try to keep hidden, what closets you don't want anyone to look into, Jesus doesn't turn you away. He isn't kicking you out because of your past deeds. He doesn't reject you, even though we are sinners. In fact, the text says, all that the Father forgives come to me. And whoever comes to me, I will never turn away. I will never cast out. That's a comfort that we can't find in other places in this world. And then he does something incredible. He says to the disciples, you feed them. You feed this hangry group of people. Now he's not telling them to do this because he actually expected that they were going to be able to put together a meal. He was doing this to show not only the disciples but the crowd also that we cannot provide our own comfort, that we can't bring peace to our own hearts, that we have to look beyond ourselves, beyond our ability, even beyond our own humanity, to find peace and hope and comfort. The disciples thought, well, we'll give it a try. And somehow they come up with a couple pieces of bread and a few handful of fishes. And then they're supposed to feed this group of people. What are they supposed to do? Take one lick and pass it out alone? Isn't it great that none of these kids wanted to do that? How many would have joined in that role? Yeah, this was not about to be able to feed these people. They weren't all going to get just one sniff or one taste or just enough to tide them over. This was not an appetizer until later in the evening when they could all have a good meal at home. Jesus knew this wasn't good. This wasn't going to satisfy. So he provides them a meal that not only satisfies their soul, but not only gives everyone enough to eat, but has plenty of leftovers to prove that the God who created bread and fish has no problem multiplying bread and fish. He shows that he's the Lord of everything and nothing is out of his touch. He is at least a prophet in the role of Moses who fed them with the manna in the wilderness, or Elijah who multiplied the grain and the oil for the widow. He's so much more than that. He doesn't just give them a fish sandwich. He is going to give them something far greater, a food that will last for all eternity. Look carefully at what Jesus does. He has compassion on people, not just for their hunger, but for their hungry souls. They're not just hangry in their stomach. They're hangry because of their sin and their loss. And then he does something amazing. The text says, he looked up to heaven, said a blessing, broke the loaves, and gave it to them. Does that sound familiar? Took the bread, broke it, and gave it to them, saying, take, eat. On this night, he was betrayed. He took bread and gave it to the disciples and gave it to them. This was their ultimate meal. This was a picture of God providing a meal that is even better than we can imagine. Remember that the value of a meal is in direct proportion to the hunger. And our greatest hunger is not what comes in our stomachs, but what comes in our hearts. And he feeds us a meal that will satisfy all who come.